The story begins with a woman who married into one of the other groups of Dakota and Lakota people. And for some reason, she went to live with her husband's people, which was far to the south in a place today called Nebraska. And of course, that's Nebraska in our language. The place where the earth is flattened is what that means. And that's where they were living. And the wife noticed that her husband was mean. He liked to hit her. And no matter how much she told him that wasn't the proper thing to do, he shouldn't do that, he continued to do that. He also liked to gamble. Whatever belongings they had, he would always take them and bet them in the different gambling games. And she said that that wasn't good for him to be doing that, because then they could never have their home and the family the way that they should. He would never say anything, but then again, he would continue then that same practice of violence toward her and continuing the gambling. So she decided then that she would have to leave him. So she went to see her mother-in-law, and she told her what she was planning to do. She said, "You know, your son always hits me." And she said, "He always gambles. I've asked him not to do that, and I've tried to remain with him for as long as I could, but," she said, "it doesn't seem like there's going to be any change, and I don't want to continue living that way." Here her mother-in-law said, "I don't know why he is like that, but I have noticed that he is like that. I notice that he hits you and that he also is always gambling. And I have talked to him about it a number of times and tried to find out why he can't change, but," she said, "it seems as if he doesn't hear me." So the woman told her mother-in-law, "I have decided that I will have to leave, and where my people are is far from here, and I will have to walk that entire distance, and it is a long ways. So I have started to make preparations by making footwear, moccasins for myself. And I have made a number of pairs, but it's a long, long ways, and I don't know if they will last. And I've also made a lot of dried meat and have packed that so that I will be able maybe to reach where they are before that all runs out." Her mother-in-law said, "It is very sad that you have to leave and that you and my son will never have a home and you'll never have a family. But because of these conditions and that he will never change, I know that it can be no other way. So wait a few days," she said, "I'll try to make you some moccasins too that you can wear and carry. And I will make some dried meat for you and some pemmican so you can carry that along with you when you go." When her husband went into the gambling hall, she told her mother-in-law, "I saw him go into the gambling lodge, so then I will start my journey now." And her mother-in-law said, "Yes, I saw him enter the gambling lodge also, so he will be in there for a long time. So then you should start now." And she gave her the things she made for her. So then the daughter-in-law started to come toward the north where she knew her people were. And her mother-in-law told her before she left, "By the time he comes out of the lodge, you will be a long distance from here. And he probably won't be looking for you, so you will be able to get away." And so then the woman started to come toward the north. But she didn't want to travel too much during the daylight because she thought somebody might see her and would try to kill her or else take advantage of her in some way. So she always walked when it was dark. She had to be extra careful because, of course, there are holes and other things about in the dark. And, of course, when she had to cross a stream, She had to make sure she crossed where it wasn't too deep. But you know how it is when we know where the water is not deep, where it's shallow. You can hear how the water makes these riffles and it goes over the rocks. So she would always try to find places like that and would take off her moccasins and wade across. But the main thing was to keep traveling in a northerly direction, and she could look at the North Star and knew that she was going north. And of course, when it was cloudy, that wasn't so easy, but she still kind of had a general idea, which was north. So she just continued to travel and travel. So then she had run out of food. It was spring when she left that village of her husband. And she'd walked all during those months, and she knew it was starting to turn to be the autumn or the fall time, because the wind was starting to get cold. She wore out all the moccasins that she had, because she walked and walked and walked. And she ate up all the dried meat, the pemmican that she had. And she began to kind of think, now what am I going to do? And she sat down on this little hill to rest. She got to thinking, what am I going to do? I have no more footwear, and I have no more food. It's starting to get to be winter. I probably will starve, or else I'll freeze to death. And I will never see my relatives again, she thought. And she started to cry. Sitting there crying and thinking about that she had come that far now and she was not going to make it maybe. So she was crying, and she sensed that somebody came and sat down beside her. But she was crying so hard she didn't stop and hear whoever this was spoke to her and said, "My daughter, why are you crying?" So then she opened her eyes to look, and here it was, Coyote sitting there. So she got kind of frightened, but then she thought to herself, it talked to me, so I have to answer it. So she told Coyote why she was sitting there crying. She told Coyote how she'd come all that distance, clear across that great area, how she had all these moccasins, but she wore them all out, how she had all this pemmican and dried meat, and on the way she ate all the natural foods that she could find, the berries and the vegetables that grow, but now there was nothing, and she was completely out of food. And the thing that she was feeling so bad about is that she probably would never see her relatives again. So then she lived with the coyotes in their cave during the winter months. She saw how the coyotes tended to their young ones, the two little ones that were born. They treated them so nice, always attentive to them, attending to their every needs, and that they never let them be unhappy. So when these coyotes got to be young ones and they were like young children, they were so happy and they played, and the woman could just sense how happy these coyotes were and that they never became angry or violent toward each other. And she thought that was just wonderful. She also saw how they kept their den, that all the bones that they picked the meat off of were always taken outside. And when the young ones had their bowel movements in the cave, the bigger coyotes took that all outdoors. They didn't just let it sit there. They took that out of the cave. And she thought, gee, these ones know how to live. They know how to live clean. They know how to live with happiness and with true understanding in their hearts. And she thought that was wonderful. And it got to be now towards spring. But the other coyotes never talked to her. The woman coyote and the young coyotes never talked to her. Just that first one that talked to her was the only one. So then this one time, then it came back and it said to her, "There's a group of people moving over north of here, and those might just possibly be your relatives. So I guess it's time then that you will have to leave us. And so you should start to get your things together. Of course, she didn't have very much, just her robe and a few other items that she put together. And so she kind of looked fondly at the Coyote family, the woman and the young ones, and just expressed her appreciation to them. And then when Coyote took her then to inside of the village and told her, I'm going to have to leave you here now. And you can call to those people and find out who they are. But I want you to know that, you know, you were welcome with us. But I want you to do something for us all the time. Whenever the people go hunting and they get game, whatever it is, take a piece of the fat and put it somewhere out on the prairie and remember us. And we will appreciate that always. So she said, I will be sure to do that. She said, I want to tell you how grateful I am that you helped me like nobody else could ever help me. Helped me come through the winter and to be a part of your family. And I'm most grateful for that. So I will do as you say. So as she walked toward her village and got within hearing distance, she called to them and asked them who they were. And they told her who they are. And she said, I am your relative, and told them her name. But she said, before I come back into the village, I need to cleanse myself. She said, I've lived in a different environment, so I need for you to make the lodge for me, the inikahapi, the lodge of renewing life. So they made it. They heated up the rocks, built the fire, heated up the rocks, and got it ready for her. So she went in there first, and she renewed herself, and then she went back to the village. Everyone was glad to see her. She told them what she learned from the coyotes, how to take care of the young ones so that they will grow up with kindness and a good heart and be always happy. And she told them how they always took care of the inside of their home, that they made sure it was clean and there was nothing old left there. And so the people were grateful for those lessons.